I'm going to start this piece by asking you all to turn off your phones. There's going to be some meditation in this part. And so much of forgiveness is being able to chill. It's very hard to chill with a phone that has your attention. And it is almost that simple, that our attention is grabbed by anything that threatens us. For most of us, the phone is a large source of threat. Emails, texts, messages that say you have something to do now, or something you should have done yesterday, or some feedback or criticism to something you did, or something that you didn't do, or something that you need to do. There is shown that we all have an adrenaline spike when we think of checking our email. The average person at work checks their email 79 times a day. That's a lot of adrenaline for no reason. It's really entertaining. And the really fascinating things about cell phones and all of technology, the reason that it's so dangerous for us, so to speak, for our quiet, is that technology grabs us through two separate mechanisms, which I find really interesting. One mechanism is the threat mechanism, the if you don't pay attention to me, your life's going to fall apart mechanism, or you know, your boss wants you, or your grandkids want you, or somebody wants you yesterday, and why the hell haven't you responded? That's the threat mechanism. The other way that the cell phone captures us is the dopamine mechanism, the pleasure mechanism. And we respond to the desire for new stimuli and for new kind of experiences by releasing a little bit of dopamine. And that's one of the problems with the phone and technology, is because there's always the opportunity for something new and different and exciting. And so we become somewhat addicted to it. And so it's very hard for most people raised in this culture to turn this off, because it's pulling at us from two separate systems, not just from the threat system, but from the addictive system. And once we're hooked into the fact that, wow, this little thing may give us, wow, for me, like, did the Yankees win? Or, you know, like, what's new? Or I haven't read this before, or that's interesting. All that stimulates dopamine. And it's very hard to put that down. It's very hard to put that down, because your brain's not always, like, in your control. And since forgiveness and all the positive emotions require us to be centered, this is a real problem. It's a real problem. That you can't access the positive parts of you without being able to still your mind a little. You just can't. And you see, like, how rattled people are, just normal day stuff. We're all rattled. But part of that is this information overload and the demands on us. But part of it is many of us never shut this down. We just don't quiet. So what I'm asking you to do is actually turn off your phones, not just put them on, you know, vibrate, to actually turn them off. Maybe you didn't hear that piece of it. Because it's too threatening to you, you know. You didn't want to take the information in, but I actually said, turn off your phone. What I do, and maybe some of your hands are shaking so much that you can't actually do this, you know. There's a Valium drip out back for those who need it. I do this kind of work for corporate America, and it always starts with turn off your technology and take a deep breath. Like, turn off your technology and then take a deep breath. Not just one deep breath, because you have to keep on breathing. You don't have to keep on watching your phone, but you do have to generally keep on breathing. There's a little discretion there, but not much. So I'm asking you to, like, turn your phone off and then dial down your nervous system. I'm looking for the poem that I'm going to read. And when I say take a deep breath, what I mean is give yourself permission to sit still and quiet. Now, one of the things that you want to do when you're quiet is see if you can make yourself safe enough that you can breathe without, like, armoring your body. This is a practice for relaxing enough to forgive, but it starts with, are you safe enough to not need your body armoring, even just in the way you're breathing? Like, can you breathe as if you're safe? And one, some helpful solutions are if your legs are crossed at the thigh, uncross them and cross them at the ankles, because that restricts some of your capacity to breathe deeply into your lower abdomen. And, like, relax. There's no hidden agenda here. This is it. So just, like, relax. Sit comfortably. Relax. From a forgiveness point of view, what you're doing is cultivating safety, where you're safe in you. So you don't need to blame what's going on in the world for why you don't feel okay. It's that simple. You're cultivating the capacity to be okay with you, so you have less need to blame something in the world for why you're not okay. Which is what generally unforgiveness is. And then at some point you don't need that, and that's when you let it go. But you can practice conditions that make letting it go more sensible, right? Because I need to remind myself that I can at least be safe sitting with just me. Like, I don't have to do anything. I don't have to change the past. I don't have to make bad people go away. I don't have to change who my mother is in order to sit safely by myself. Which is what we're all doing when we're active and unforgiving. I'll be safe when dead mom stops hating me, or whatever it is, or, you know, I'll be safe when they apologize, or I'll be safe when hell freezes over. Whenever it is, you'll be safe. You want to practice being safe now, with the world exactly as it is. Exactly as it is. And so that means, very clearly, you need to slow your breathing down. You need to practice emphasizing that your abdomen expands when you inhale, and that your chest and shoulders don't move very much, that you're safe. And so you breathe in the way that only an animal being safe breathes. Like, no animal under threat will relax its abdomen at all. because it's vulnerable. You need to practice safety. And so that means that you're inhaling and expanding your belly, not resisting. I mean, again, you're cultivating a quality. And so you want to breathe in a way that's cooperating with the way you were meant to breathe, which is slowly and deeply, so that you oxygenate as much of your brain as possible. And that you practice being safe with the world as it actually is. But that will not happen as long as you're not breathing and expanding your belly to welcome the air. And not obviating that by opening up so that you want this to open, not that, your belly. Because that's vulnerable, and that allows you to hold experiences without running from them. You just want to sit. And now I'm going to ask you all to close your eyes if you haven't already. Close your eyes. And the first thing I'm going to do is just read you a poem, just my favorite forgiveness poem. It's called A Settlement by Mary Oliver. She's just wonderful, but this is just, I don't know. You know, she teaches in like 12 lines what people take weeks to teach. Look, it's spring, and last year's loose dust has turned into this soft willingness. The windflowers have come up trembling. Slowly, the brackens are uplifting their curvaceous and pale bodies. The thrushes have come home, none less than filled with mystery, sorrow, happiness, music, ambition. And I am walking out into all of this with nowhere to go and no task undertaken, but to turn the pages of this beautiful world over and over in the world of my mind. Therefore, dark past, I'm about to do it. I'm about to forgive you for everything. I'll just read that one more time and then. But make sure while you're hearing this, you're still breathing slowly and deeply. Like, that's so crucial for your own nervous system's alignment and ability to hear. Look, it's spring, and last year's loose dust has turned into this soft willingness. The windflowers have come up trembling. Slowly, the brackens are uplifting their curvaceous and pale bodies. The thrushes have come home, none less than filled with mystery, sorrow, happiness, music, ambition. And I am walking out into all of this with nowhere to go and no task undertaken but to turn the pages of this beautiful world over and over in the world of my mind. Therefore, dark past, I'm about to do it. I'm about to forgive you for everything. So you wanna inside of yourself, just see if you agree with that statement, I'm about to forgive the world for everything. For being the way it is. And what this means is at some level you're letting go of yourself as an individual entity whose purpose is to judge everything. Like, you're stepping away from that conceit and saying, I want to remain at peace. So it's not like I'm forgiving my brother or my neighbor or myself. At some level, what I'm agreeing to do is rejoin the world without my criticism of it. Like, at least for a moment, I will allow the world to be as it is. And I forgive the world. What I'm actually doing is forgiving the ways that I don't agree with how the world unfolded. So I'm saying that my judgments, I'm releasing them for a moment. I'm just releasing my judgment for a moment. Therefore, dark past, I forgive everything. Because it's not forgiving anything specific, it's just I forgive my judgment, my criticism of life. I let that go. And now before we're done, I'm going to ask you to do one more thing. Just let that go, but leave your eyes closed. Let that specific thing go. And bring an image to your mind before we finish of someone you really adore. Just bring an image to your mind of someone you absolutely and totally adore. And hold that image clearly and see if you can feel in your mind how much you adore this person. You want to try to feel it in your body. And just, again, relax for a moment into your capacity to generate safety for yourself by remembering love. You can generate safety. And then let that all go, take a breath, and allow your eyes to open. So in my conception, or part of my conception, I'm interested in what it is that we do to take ourselves away from our own center. Like how we allow life and our reaction to life to rob us of our peace and good feeling. Like, that's what my interest is in forgiveness, not what people or the world has done, but how we take those events and literally destroy our peace of mind with those events, like how we do that. And then what we can do to unravel that, you know, how we can unravel it so that we can be safe and okay as normal hurt people or normal people who have been violated or normal people who have done it to other people. Like, we're normal if we've done wrong or been wrong. That's a definition almost of being here. And so my interest is in asking people to themselves to stop doing that to themselves. So one of the things that we do in our training is we almost never listen to people's stories. Almost never. Because there are a lot of blah, 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 blah. I'm just letting you know. They're just blah, 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 blah. It's almost like the New Yorker cartoons where the dog is looking up at the master and the master's going on for like 12 lines with all this complicated prose and all the dog hears is food. And out. So the dog master's talking, you know, look at my cute little dog, and, you know, he's a Pekingese and blah, 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 and we feed him, and then the dog's ears pick up because that's the only thing that's relevant to the dog, and the rest is just blah, 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 blah. So in our work, most of it's just blah, 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 blah. That we all have drama, and we have to be careful about the drama that we've constructed. And generally speaking, that construct is our problem, not the experience. Which is one of the reasons why I don't take many questions. Because I find that most questions are simply one variant of, this happened to me, it's not fair. I know forgiveness is good for everybody else, but you didn't meet my mother-in-law. That's the basic question that I get. Explain to me why it is that I have to follow the normal rules of human life, because I had this really bad experience, or my brother had this really bad experience, or my tribe, or my racial group, or my religious group. We really suffered. And so therefore, everything you say is fine for other people. But I'm really offended. Or, that makes sense. However, in this particular instance, I want to pass from normal consequences for disliking my life. I want the freedom to dislike my life, but never have high blood pressure or angst from it. That's the other question that I get all the time. How do I continue to hate my mother without suffering the consequences? Those are the most common questions that I get in one variant or another. And then people argue literally for their own limitations. That's usually what happens. So I don't find that useful. I don't find it useful from either side, but it's definitely not useful for me. What is useful is questions that arise as to how do I get over myself? How do I change the way that I'm holding it so that I don't have to have this consequence? How do I deal with this more skillfully? Those are useful questions. What do I do to change? You know, it's the conundrum of psychotherapy. Most people, certainly marriage therapy, most people enter marriage therapy to change their partner. Because they figure the objective therapist will agree with them. You know, that when you meet my husband, you'll know why this has been a tough 25 years. That's the primary loading for therapy. You know, like you'll find, and you almost, you know, they come in almost expecting that the therapist will pin a medal on them for enduring this person for so many years. Like, oh my God, you are a saint. That anybody else married to this person, they'd have shot them by now. That's the most common thing that gets people into couples therapy. But you'll agree with me. Doesn't work. The concern is that people who do that haven't properly grieved. They haven't fully felt how bad it feels, and they haven't accepted that they're stuck in that. That's the issue. That they're stuck in their grieving. That's not the partner or anybody else's fault. So that's why when people want questions, I have them write them on little cards, and I translate the questions sometimes into something that's useful. Not, what's wrong with my mother-in-law? Or what's wrong with my husband? Or what's wrong with me? There's nothing wrong with any of us. We just are challenged to figure out how to cope with our lives. That's the key. We're all challenged to try to cope. So one of the practices that is helpful beyond measure is to calm down. Then you have a chance of asking the right questions. Like, calm down. One of the things that when somebody asks me, and I love this, how do I know when I've forgiven? But one of the entertaining parts that comes with this is, how do I know that I've forgiven that bastard? My hypothesis is they still have work to do. Like, how do I know I've forgiven that SOB? Maybe you're not ready. But the other one, the hostile, you know, I know my father couldn't help how bad he was. That he was raised by terrible parents, so I understand why he was such an awful, terrible father. That's not forgiveness either. It's not. The way you know that you've forgiven is if you can talk about your life without raising your own blood pressure. It's that simple.
Oh, that's a good one.
Right? If you can talk about your own life without raising your blood pressure, you've forgiven. It has nothing to do with them. Can you talk about it without causing yourself a stroke? They have nothing to do with it. Nothing. And it's interesting when we recognize that it's about us. How are we coping? Are we quieting down? Are we talking about it in ways that don't lead us to require CPR? Right? Anyway, one more meditation moment, please. Everybody close your eyes. And sit up a little bit straight. This is not a formal meditation, but I want you to sit up straight. Just in part so you don't fall asleep, or you don't keel over, or you don't fall on the person next to you, or all these things. Sit up relatively straight. Eyes closed. And just take two slow, deep breaths into and out of your belly. You can't get enough practice in real abdominal breathing. And that means your belly expands and you get fatter. And you don't hold your stomach in. That you actually, if you want to, feel grateful for the fact that you have a body that works, that allows you to breathe, that means your diaphragm muscles are working, and everything's the way it should be if you can have an expanded abdomen. You want to be thankful for that, not afraid of the fact that you have a belly. And then what I'd like you to do is bring an image to your mind of someone you don't like. You don't have to hate them, just somebody you don't like, or somebody who did something to you that you don't like what they did. And then I want you to notice just the simplest thing, where does adrenaline catch you? Because anytime you picture anyone that has harmed you or you don't like, you've already released adrenaline way before you're conscious of it, because you're threatened. This is just the simplest stuff. You've shown an image to your body of a threat. So it's going to release adrenaline instantly to help you deal with it, instantly. So you want to notice where in your body you're caught by the adrenaline. And you just want to catalog for just a moment what it does to you. You know, does your heart speed up? Does your back get tight? Does your belly feel a little off? Do your thoughts get less pleasant? The answer is sometimes yes to all of that. But immediately, you'll have a reaction to that. And then when you note it, just take a deep breath, allow that to sit for a minute and open your eyes. Just open your eyes back, bring them back to me. So from the most secular, simple, intelligent thing that we could come up with, forgiveness is in some level simply an adrenaline management system. I can't make it, that makes it so unthreatening to most people. Right? You're just learning to manage your adrenaline response. It's not necessarily a spiritual quality. I mean, I respect all the traditions that present it as a spiritual quality. It doesn't have to be a spiritual quality. It can be a spiritual quality. It can be simply a heart disease prevention quality. It's fine. I don't think the universe cares what we call it. I mean, that's my deep belief, that all that's silly to be worried. I mean, again, there's so many ways to do this. But from I developed this, you know, working at Stanford's medical school. It's an adrenaline management training system. It's a lot of other things too, but that way you can do it fastest. And you don't have to worry about whether your mother's dead or alive. You just practice. So what happens is, when you think of something you don't like or somebody you don't like, your body adrenalizes immediately. You can't stop that. That's what you're forgiving, is the way you frame something that causes your body to adrenalize. That's actually what you're releasing. You're releasing your creation of a threat that causes your body to respond with adrenaline. And then most of us blame that discomfort on something outside of ourself. Right? That's the game. we frame, now, again, somebody harms, like, you know, we've heard awful things. Somebody rapes your daughter at knife point. It's legitimate for a year to bring up images that cause you to feel threatened. That's like, duh. It's just you don't want to do that for 5 years. But part of the process of grieving and assimilating is it is a threat to you. That's true. It's just not endlessly a threat, but it is a threat. So what you're doing is you want to practice being comfortable, being threatened, so it can end when it's necessary. Like, you want to accept the painful feelings. You don't want to reject them. I mean, they're uncomfortable as hell, but they're meant to be uncomfortable. Because you're threatened. You damn well better be uncomfortable. You just don't want to stay there. So forgiveness, again, isn't a response to limit pain. I mean, it limits it temporally, but not humanly, of course. You know, if somebody harms somebody in your family or yourself, you'd be a moron if you didn't feel pain, if you weren't threatened. That would be crazy. But you don't want to create a worldview that burdens you over time. You want to grieve the wound. It's essential. But after a while, in healthy people, they get sick of their own way of dealing with it, which makes them unhappy. You know what I mean? After a while, they get more tired of them than they do with the event. That's what healthy people do. All right, I'm sick of talking about this already. Enough. Or, you know, Jesus, let me just let this rest. I mean, every time I think about my father, my heart hurts. So I need to stop. But it's not like you need to shut anybody down. In fact, if you're with somebody who's been harmed for a while after the harm, you do them more good by listening than shutting them down. Because then they get a chance to make themselves tired of it rather than you making them tired of it, which is true. People need to talk and share and have empathy and compassion and, you know, advice and all that stuff. They need that. We all need that. And then in healthy people, it's enough. It's enough. I've gotten my share. I mean, the Jewish tradition has, what, a year of sitting after the death of somebody for active mourning, and then you make a ritual, and it's on to the next person who lost somebody. It's not yours forever. I mean, that's the truth of life. But you need time to suffer. And there's no, like, you know, you can't push it. So, but after a while, and the severity of the event has a lot to do with how long you need to suffer. So if somebody cuts you off on the freeway and you give them the finger for 12 seconds, that's legitimate suffering. It's just telling everybody for the next 6 months is kind of ridiculous. Yeah, but that's, you know, so if you're fired, that might be 2 months, you know what I mean? It's not endless. But if you don't let it out, then you're not fully human either. That's the thing. You got to embrace the whole humanity of it. You know, I'm a human person who suffers, and I have other capacities that let me release it without constantly contempting and being hostile and blaming the world. Like, you want it all. I mean, that's like the full catastrophe. You know, you're not pushing. You're not saying I'm holier than everybody else. And, you know, you're holding the world's pain by holding your pain. And then you release your portion of it. You know, you go back. So, but what we're releasing after a while is the parts of us that caused us to be adrenalized every time this situation emerges for us. That's what you're letting go of. Right? The way you're holding it. What we're forgiving at some level is the story that we created around something that causes us to be angry or despairing every time we tell that story. We want to release that story. It's not like you're going to forget about what happened. I mean, sometimes, you know, people say, is forgiving the same as forgetting? Which is idiotic. Because how do you forget, like, really terrible things? It's like I joke, I had a, you know, my son John, I haven't seen him in 5 years. I wonder what happened. Like, that's ridiculous. What you, forgiveness is remembering differently without the storm. You don't forget, but you remember differently. Okay, one more meditation moment. Please close your eyes. And remember, the breaths are into and out of your belly. And that requires also for you to open your belly below your navel, not just above your navel, but below your navel. And then you want to bring that image back to your mind of someone you really adore. And you want to relax into that image. You want to relax. I mean, metaphorically, you're opening your heart, but you want to relax. Relax into your own openness or goodness or whatever it is. Just relax into it. And then just for a moment, just ask the relaxed part of you, how could I handle that hurt? Like, what could I do if I were calm, centered, and loving? What could I do about that person or thing that hurts me? How could I handle it if this part of me were in charge? What would I do? And then just listen inside for a moment and then take a deep breath, let it all go, and allow your eyes to open. So one of the things that I learned was that the adrenalized part of ourselves can't help us. So if you get an angry person, which is the problem without when you don't draw real limits in couples therapy, which is you have to be nice to each other. If you don't insist upon that, then their bad habits just show up. And since bad habits tend to be adrenalized, they're not going to be able to think creatively and do anything differently. So I came to see that forgiveness simply requires us to calm down, open our hearts, relax, and then see what's there. Like, what's in me that doesn't need an enemy? Like, what does that part of me talk about? And most of the work that we do is aimed at giving people access to that part of them, not rehashing over and over and over again how bad it was or how unfair it was or what their brother didn't do or what they didn't do. You wanna give them access to the part of them that their negativity has closed off. Like, that's really what you're doing. So forgiveness comes naturally to an open-hearted, grateful person. Like, they don't need to hunt it down. It's just there. It comes very difficultly to an angry, self-absorbed person. But if you have a story inside you that keeps on generating anger and, you know, self-absorption, then you're never going to uncover the part of you that forgives, which is why I don't take those questions, which is why we don't listen endlessly to all the ways that people have been harmed. They're infinite. It's fine. But what we want to do is help them stop that story that is making them miserable and recognize how they're contributing to their own misery and see if they can come up with a better plan. And it works. I mean, not everybody, not for everything, but for many, many things that I can't tell you. Like, how many therapeutic failures we have had come into our forgiveness project, where the therapist wants to hear about their mother or whatever it is and endlessly explores their past and all the stuff they've had to deal with and blah, 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 blah. If they've never talked about it, this is the key thing. If somebody hasn't talked about their pain a couple of times, they need to talk about it. So if somebody comes to us and says, this happened 40 years ago, but I've never shared it, we'll probably tell them to go away and share it for a while, then come back when you're ready to forgive. The other side is just as problematic, which is they've been sharing it ad nauseum. Then you want them to shut up and not share it again. Right? It's like you want some health. So if you've never shared it, talk. Right, go find people to listen, talk, write it down, you know, do whatever you need to let the world know that you were harmed. That's essential too. But if you've been telling everybody you meet for 30 years, then shut it down. And the best thing you could do is never talk about it again. Like, just... I know this is so simple. It really is. So simple. And if you're quiet inside, you can grasp the simplicity of it. And then you just got the hard work of practicing. But the simplicity is there, and it's obvious. That, wait a second. If I've made a storyline out of how the world didn't treat me right, I've created such grooves in my head that are going to make me unhappy and angry every time I go there. Why do I want to do that? Why would I want to do that? So what I need to do is figure out a different story and relax. Like, I need to figure out a different story. So I need to think of, well, and the truth is, you can figure out any of 100 different stories, or 1,000. It's just that you have to recognize that what you've been telling is just one story of many. And you got stuck in it. You just got stuck in your story. That's it, you got stuck. And you kept on telling the same story, even though that story made you unhappy. That's true. So forgiveness is basically a different story. And it's one where that story doesn't imprison you or me. The really weird thing is, like our goal with the forgiveness project was to make this simple. You know, to not have theological arguments or, I was telling a couple people that asked me downstairs about some, a little bit about the religious aspect of this. When we first started the forgiveness project, we weren't certain whether we wanted to do this from a religious or a secular point of view, because we all had spiritual leanings. We just didn't know which would be the most effective, and we had a hypothesis that maybe a religious kind of point of view would tap into other people's, like, you know, spiritual nature. It didn't turn out to be true. What we found more often is that more religiously oriented people than not were stuck on their own religion. And that it was more their identification of themselves as a certain sect than it was them practicing the principles. So I'm Christian, you need Jesus. You know, and if you don't talk about Jesus, you're not really talking about forgiveness. That's what we used to get all over the place. Like, wait a second, you can't have forgiveness without Jesus. Like, what did they do before Jesus took birth? Like, that's an interesting question, right? Okay, so 2,000 years ago, since then, maybe we've needed Jesus. What did we do before? Just waited for him? Buddhists did the same thing. Like, this is really good stuff, but it's not Buddhism. Well, of course it's not Buddhism. It's forgiveness. So we gave up the religious stuff very quickly and tried to figure out how we could present it from a secular point of view that fewer people could argue with. That's really true. And we came up with, like, all right, quiet your physiology down. Do some narrative reframing, practice gratitude, and do some cognitive restructuring from any point of view that you wanted. It didn't matter. It was the practice of it that mattered. So I'm going to give you one more practice. Here's what I want you to do. Very simple reframing strategy is think of some very modest thing that has hurt you. And turn to somebody near you and talk about it. Not like a homicidal maniac, you know what I mean? Like, you know, my brother, like a normal human being. You know what I mean? Keep yourself under control. Because some people turn and they become Attila the Hun. But what I want you to do is this. I want you to talk for a few moments about somebody who hasn't lived up to your standards, which is all it is anyway. And then before you're done with the conversation, take as much time to talk about something in your life for which you're grateful. Not necessarily that person, but talk about something you're grateful for so you don't engage your nervous system just in negativity. And you can have a conversation about something that has bothered you without having to have it stick with adrenaline for the rest of your day, that it's just a life experience. Once you practice something like this a half a dozen times, you're somewhat free of the addiction from adrenaline. Because you're just saying, this painful thing happened to me, which is true, and I have this blessing, which I don't want to ignore, just because I had this pain. So you're teaching yourself that you don't have to just focus on what's wrong. But you don't ignore it, you don't deny it, you don't minimize it. You just stop your body from being assaulted by it. There's many ways of doing it. This is one simple one. So find somebody near you, maybe have a minute or so conversation about something that harmed you, and then another 45 seconds to a minute about just something that's good so that you keep your nervous system and your mind in balance. Okay, please do that. So, just not to scare all of you, if you do want to submit a question to me on one of those cards, do so. I would highly suggest you not put your name on it, because then I can, you know, I might know who asked. Such a ridiculous question. you know, make them all anonymous just to be safe. And I will look at a few of these in a minute. What I would really like you to take away from this is that this is really an issue of your consciousness and your ability to skillfully navigate your own life. Like, that's the bitter truth. Like, there's nothing always easy or pleasant about that. That blame is a placeholder that's necessary. Like, we were given blame to make space so that we can integrate things. Yeah, it's their fault, they did it, I'm not responsible. We need that. That's a necessary, like, transitory step. But that's where many of us get stuck. So it's not wrong, it's just inefficient long term. Health-wise, blame is not a good thing. The relationship of blame to medical symptoms is direct. The more blame, the more physical health problems you have. This is not a cavalier finding. This is in line with the way I teach this, which is, don't worry so much about the specifics, but look at the process by which you're handling it. It's like this is an hour and a half talk that Dr. Phil might have summarized, and how's it working for you, right? That's really what this is. How's it working for you? So if you hold your mother as the she-devil, how's that working for you? That's the thing. And so what I learned is you want to be more interested in your process than the content of your drama.
Say that again?
Yeah. That you want to be interested more in your process, how you're dealing with it, than the content of the drama. Like, how am I doing this? Not what happened. How am I handling it? How am I growing or not growing or ungrowing or whatever it is? Rather than an endless discussion of content. Most of us use the content to obscure the poor ways that we're handling it. That's what we do. We keep on bringing out how awful it is, or it was, to defend why it is we haven't figured out how to move on. I mean, this is, how would I put this? When people come to me and they tell me awful things, you know, not awful things about me necessarily, but sometimes they do, but... But when they tell me awful experiences, and I'll listen to them, and if they've told it 100 times, you can tell. You can just tell. It's already a boring story. But if it's fresh, it's compelling. Like, if you feel real human immediate suffering, you just want to help. When it's a rehashed story to gain sympathy, it's not that interesting. You can feel the manipulation in it. You just can. But one of the things that I now understand is when people tell me these painful things, I'll listen and I'll say, God, that's really awful. But what makes it more awful is I've heard that 50 times already. that if it was just you and it was an anomaly, then I'm truly sorry, but that's, you know, that's not so bad. But that it's so common, that's so bad. You know, that not everybody, but most of us have a painful story to tell. And it's the ubiquitousness that is so painful. You know, that again, if it happened once, okay, it's like a meteor hits, you know what I mean? That ain't so bad. But that cruelty and unkindness are so common, and that we limit our empathy by over-focusing on ourselves, that's not good. That's what's not so good. Okay, I'll look at these. Is this all I get, is two?
Sir.
Oh, more, look at this, okay. So this one is, your examples have had to do with personal issues, but many people have grievances about larger issues, such as the world situation. Okay. I mean, that's a legitimate question. It just doesn't change the process at all. So again, for me, I'll just tell you, one of the things that I struggle with on a large scale, I'm a vegetarian. I don't like all the ways that people kill animals. The latest data is that in the United, I think it's the United States, but it may be the world, 50 billion animals and 70 billion fish were killed this year for human consumption. So that's a problem. Thank you. But if I get myself angry about it and demonize all the other people doing it, it's no different than if I was doing that about my mother-in-law. My process is the same. So there's no larger or smaller. There's just my capacity to make other people an enemy, to explain my discomfort, to explain how this thing in the world isn't the way I want it to be. And instead of being able to cope successfully with it, which is, you know, Fred, nobody said that the world was going to be the way you wanted it to be. Who gave you that? Where'd you come up with that? Like, you think because you eat a certain way, everybody's got to eat that way? Now, you may think you're right, and that's fine, but that's you thinking you're right. So how do you deal with the fact that the rest of the world doesn't agree with you? That's your question, not what's wrong with them. I mean, you can know what's wrong with them because that informs your opinion, but then the question is how you're effective within that. It's the same question, whether it's one thing or 100 things or 500 things. It's how do you attune your consciousness so that you're effective, right? One of the things that I have said along those lines to challenge people is, and I'm not trying to make light of anything, that I've said, and I've been a vegetarian for 30 plus years. If we were in a cow meeting, like if you were all cows, I'm just saying, if this was a cow conference, then those of you who eat meat would be much worse to the cows than Hitler, because he was a vegetarian. So it's all your perspective, I'm just letting you know. As unattractive as that is, it's all your, it's like whose ox is being gored, so to speak. If this were a cow conference, many of you are in the shit list. But that's putting it into perspective. That it's all, there's always some personal thing that gets triggered. Because there is so much offense in the world, so much unkindness, it's more like choose your problem. So I choose vegetarianism, somebody else chooses abuse, somebody else chooses oil spills, somebody else chooses overpopulation. You can choose them infinitely, they're all true. It's just how do you deal with an imperfect world? Do you see what I'm getting at? Okay. What is your suggestion for when your situation drags on out of your control. Okay, well, it's always, I mean, it's, unless you have control over somebody else, it's always out of your control, time-wise. It's hard when any of us have to deal with painful realities over and over. That's just hard. The tendency is to keep on blaming because it doesn't stop. But that's practicing ongoing unforgiveness, which is it didn't stop yesterday, it didn't stop 2 months ago, it didn't stop today, it's not going to stop tomorrow. That's bad. But instead of looking inside for how is it that I'm framing it so I'm continuing to upset myself, we argue with the fact that it's not stopping. When a wiser person might say, this is just something I don't control, so I better be careful as to how I talk to myself about it. And if I continue to make myself agitated because it's not changing, then unfortunately, since it's not changing, what I need to lurk at is my impatience, as hard as that is, because it's not changing. Okay. And I'm not advocating to be in situations that are difficult that don't change. I like this question. This person says, a friend experienced major trauma and has closed off, explaining he can't feel or grieve 50 years later. And is there a way to compassionately encourage an opening? You know, I don't know. Maybe that's the best they can do. I mean, sometimes things are so overwhelming that the person believes it will be too much to let in, and they'll drown in it, and so they're just protecting themselves. I don't know if that's wrong. What I would say is the only strategy that I've ever offered to for people to give to friends is to say, hey, I see you're suffering, or maybe you're not suffering. I'm suffering because I want you to be different. But whatever it is, are you open to talking about this? Like that, just ask permission, can we talk? And then share your experience. But there's something in this that says, I know what's best for you, and you can't be certain of that. I mean, you can hope so, but you can't be certain. And I don't know. I feel unsafe and scared when people betray or lie to me. Well, you are. Where's the news to that? I feel like a lost little girl that I want to hide. I don't know that you want to change that. I just think what you want to do is recognize that that's the way you're handling being scared. And it makes sense to hide for a little while. It's just that you don't want to stay hidden. Like, if you notice that somebody lies to you, there's nothing wrong with withdrawing and licking your wounds and saying, wow, this is a tough world. And, you know, my God, I'm again confronted with this. But I am 47 years old and I'm not 3. And so at some point I got to go back out and deal with it. But the hiding, there's nothing wrong with that. It's like you're just preparing a way to handle it if you could. I mean, our strategies are good. You just don't want to get locked into them. I wouldn't fight your tendencies. All I'm suggesting is just don't stay so stuck in them. But it's a legitimate tendency. I don't get this. Comment on your thinking of 5 years of therapy every week for an hour of telling your sad story ad infinitum. What's wrong with that? Well, there's nothing wrong with it for the therapist's pocketbook. really good. This is a good question. I'll hold this for last. I only got about two more minutes. So it's what happens when you have to forgive yourself. Oh, this is what happened that you stopped blaming your friend. Those will be the two I'll stop with. Those are really good questions. The way I stopped blaming my friend was my wife came to me, this is a long time ago, and she said, Fred, I love you, but I like you less. And, you know, you're less than the person I married because you're bitter and you just, this warped you. And that's not what I signed on for. I mean, she wasn't unkind. She was just clear, like you can do better than this. I mean, that's really what it was. And she had probably been saying that for years. I just heard it. You're laughing. I don't mean that to be funny. I mean it to be absolutely true. I'm sure she said that for years. I just finally opened my ears and heard it. And it shamed me because it's not right. So because of that, I started to look at, well, what can I do to stop doing this? Because, like, she didn't do anything to me, you know? And it's, I realized that I was leaking all over the place. I mean, it was just, it wasn't no longer his bad, it was my bad. So for the first time, I had to investigate forgiving him. Okay, so you know you're right, Fred, but it's not working. I mean, that's really what happened. You're absolutely right. He was an SOB, blah, 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 and look what you're doing. So I had to choose at some level to forgive him, and I did. And we're now the best of friends again. I mean, it's like, yeah. Because when you forgive somebody, there's no longer a story about what's wrong with them. It's like, that's done. So, okay. Last one is, what happens when it's myself that I need to forgive? That's a really good question and is a, you know, a parallel track on how do you forgive yourself. And it's a really important thing. I'm not going to go into it in huge depth because it's 529, but I really want to honor the question. Some of the small differences are, one, when you're forgiving yourself, you can change. And this is something essential. Other people don't have to do anything just because you're upset with them. They don't have to be nice, they don't have to do anything. You can actually change your behavior and attitudes. So if you did something based on, you know, whatever it was, you can grow. That's huge. But you need to cultivate that. Like, you need to look yourself and say, okay, you know, I drank too much, or I was too ambitious and I never saw my kids. Whatever it was, you can change. And so you can do the best of your can, make it right. The other piece that is essential to self-forgiveness is, wherever possible, apologize. One of the reasons that forgiving others is so challenging is we can't force them to apologize. We can't even force them to care. So those two things are so crucial in the self-forgiveness piece, which is absolutely make sure, and this I got from the 12-step programs, absolutely make sure wherever possible you apologize and make amends. Absolutely. That is the crucial step. I'm sorry, how can I make it right? And then the second piece is do things that make you different. So the feeling piece doesn't matter so much. It's like, okay, you're upset with yourself, so what? Do something. Like, that's what's crucial, because you can. With somebody else, you can't make them do anything. You can't make them make it right. You can't make them apologize. You can't do anything to influence them if they don't want to be influenced. And that leads to incredible helplessness. When it's you, you can do something, and so that's a way through it. It's like you can make it right. Anyway, I'm going to have to leave in a few minutes for the airport. Thank you for your attention, and I hope you learned something. Thank you.